Hello student, today I am going to start the new topic, that is diuretic drugs or diuretics, from unit 2 of the medicine chemistry 2. Diuretic, a chemical agent that increases the rate of urine formations, means it increases the excretion of urine by kidney. They lead to the secretion of excess water and salt that accumulate in tissue and urine, which results in decrease in body fluids, especially the extracellular fluid. Most of the diuretics, they act by inhibition of sodium reabsorption at the one or more four major sites along the nephron. The most of the diuretics, they act by inhibition of sodium reabsorption. Because of inhibition of sodium reabsorption, sodium is retained in the tubular fluid, and this sodium ions, to that sodium ion the water get followed, and because of that there is increase in the urine formation. So the term diuretic has come to mean that any agent that will inhibit the tubular reabsorption of sodium. Diuretic main mechanism of action is inhibition of sodium reabsorption. The sodium reabsorption is occur at four major sites in the nephron, and the mechanism of the sodium reabsorption or transport at this each location is unique, means the mechanism of reabsorption at four site is the different than each other, and because of that different mechanism, the inhibition require the different structural features. So all the classes of diuretic does not have same structure, they having a different structural features to inhibit the sodium reabsorption. Now we see the anatomy of nephron or the function of the nephron. The functional unit of kidney is the nephron, where urine is formed. Nephron consists two major parts, two anatomical parts, that is glomerulus and tubules. Here the glomerulus and the remaining part is the whole blood is the tubules. The glomerulus part is close and cup shape and known as a Bowman's capsule. Here the shape cup shape, and this is called as the Bowman's capsule. The tubule consists four major parts. First is proximal converted tubule here. Second is loop of Henle. Third is the distal converted tubule, and last is the collecting tubules or collecting duct. I'm not going in details because you have studied this, the urinary system, in the APHE. So I just overlook the process of urine formation. As the blood reaches at the glomerular, it is filtered by the Bowman's capsule. The blood get filtered, the non-essential part the waste material from the blood, it is get filtered. After filtration, the filtrate reaches at proximal converted tubule. Here the filtrate reaches at the proximal converted tubule, where the reabsorption of sodium chloride, calcium ions, bicarbonate, phosphate ions, some amino acid and low molecular weight protein takes place. At PCT, in short proximal converted tubule, PCT, the required or essential ions, they get reabsorbed again into the blood along with some of the proteins. Next, filtrate reaches at loop of Henle, where the filtrate become diluted due to the half of the sodium and chloride ion get reabsorbed. The another side where sodium ions are reabsorbed is the distal converted tubules, where sodium cation exchange with the potassium, which is under the control of aldosterone here. The last and final site where the sodium ion reabsorbs is the place, it is take place at the collecting duct, where sodium ions from renal tubular fluid is exchanged for the potassium ions, and for less extent it is exchanged with the hydrogen ions from the blood. The tubule normally reabsorb 90% total. This tubule normally reabsorb over 90% of glomerular filtrate. The rest of the filtrate and tubular secretion, it get pass into the bladder and it is excreted as a urine. So this is the normal urinary function of the kidney. Next part is the classification of diuretics. It is classified under mainly five class. Here the four class are mentioned. The first is thiazide diuretics. Example, chlorothiazide, hydrochlorothiazide. Second, loop diuretic. Example, furosemide, ethacrenic acid. Third is potassium sparing diuretic, spironolactone, amiloride. Fourth is carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. Example is acetazolamide, methazolamide. And the last class, which is not mentioned here, is the osmotic diuretic. Remember, osmotic diuretics. Example is mannitol. Now we'll see one by one class. So our first class under diuretic is carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. These diuretics, it is act on the proximal converted tubules. So this is the site of the action of carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, is the proximal converted tubule. Now we see the mechanism of action. Here this part is tubular fluid, this part is the tubular fluid, this is tubular cell, and here the peritubal capillary, means the blood. Normally bicarbonate ion, it split into the water and the carbon dioxide. This water and carbon dioxide is diffused into the tubular cells and combine each other again into the H2CO3, that is bicarbonate ion. This bicarbonate ion split into the H plus and bicarbonate ion. Bicarbonate, it split into the H plus and bicarbonate ions. Next, normally this hydrogen H plus, it is exchanged, it come outside the proximal converter and it is exchanged with the sodium. Sodium comes into this tubular cell, and in peritubal capillary, or we can say blood, the sodium inside the tubular cell, it is exchanged with the potassium. It is exchanged with the potassium, and thus sodium get reabsorbed into the blood. So this is the normal mechanism occur at the PCT, proximal converted tubule, where sodium get reabsorbed. Now our the process of the conversion of H2CO3 into the water and carbon dioxide, plus the combination of this water and carbon dioxide into H2CO3 and splitting it into the H plus and bicarbonate ion, it is catalyzed by the carbonase anhydrase enzyme. This here carbonase anhydrase enzyme, they catalyze the splitting of H2CO3 into the H plus and bicarbonate ion. Carbonic blockage of this enzyme, the blockage of this enzyme decreases the exchange of sodium and potassium. Hence, the urine become more alkaline and the sodium retained in the tubular fluid, and sodium along with bicarbonate ion, it is excreted through the urine. Inhibition of carbonic anhydrase inhibit the reabsorption of bicarbonate ion also and the sodium ion. There is decrease in the amount of H plus ion available for the exchange of sodium. Because of this inhibition of CA, carbonic anhydrase enzyme, there is no splitting of H2CO3 into the H plus and HCO3, and because of there is no production of H plus, so H plus is unavailable for the exchange of sodium, so this process gets stopped. The sodium remain in the tubular fluid and it get excreted. The sodium, it is followed by the water, and more amount of water it is excreted along with the sodium and bicarbonate ion. So this is the mechanism of action of the carbonase anhydrase inhibitor. And because of sodium carbonate, presence of sodium carbonate and the blockage of exchange of hydrogen, the urine become more alkaline. Now this is the interaction of the H2CO3. This is the site where the interaction of this is the H2CO3 with the carbonase anhydrase enzyme. This is this enzyme, and here the binding site of the H2CO3 with the carbonate anhydrase. Here oxygen form a hydrogen bond, here another second oxygen form a hydrogen bond, this H is form a hydrogen bond, another hydrogen from this, it form a hydrogen bond with nitrogen. So this is the binding site. This is the binding interaction of the H2CO3 with the carbonate anhydrase. Similarly, the carbonase anhydrase inhibitors, they consist the R, SO2, NH2 group. They contain R, SO2, NH2 group, sulfamyl group, and this also having affinity towards the carbonase anhydrase. So these drugs which having a SO2 NH2 group, they get bind with the carbonyl anhydrase similar as the H2CO3. Here the binding site 1, 2, 3 and the 4. So because of the binding of this carbonyl anhydrase inhibitor with the carbonyl anhydrase enzyme, this enzyme action is inhibited. Now the history of carbonase anhydrase inhibitors, they obtain from the drug that is sulfanilamide. The sulfanilamide or the similar category of the drugs, they are used for the bacterial infection, antibacterial. They are used as a antibacterial, but it is observed that they produces the mild diuresis, but weakly, means this is not the severe side effect, means they produces the mild diuresis, and it is observed that दिस डायोरेटिक एक्शन इज बिकॉज ऑफ द इनिबिशन ऑफ रीनल कार्बोनिक अनहाइड्रेज इनिबिशन. सो कार्बोनिक अनहाइड्रेज इनिबिटर्स दे डेवलप फ्रॉम द सल्फानिलामाइड. टू इम्प्रूव द कार्बोनिक अनहाइड्रेज इनिबिटरी एक्शन प्रॉपर्टी ऑफ सल्फानिलामाइड, the other drugs developed from this which containing the main group, that is SO2 NH2 sulfamyl group, more number of compound where they get synthesized, and screening for the diuretic action by the ability to inhibit the carbonate anhydrase. Then they found that two groups of carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they are the simple heterocyclic sulfonylamides and metadisulfamyl benzene derivatives. The sulfonylamide is the basic drug. From that basic drug, the modification is done and number of compounds get synthesized, and screening or pharmacological action of that drug is checked for the diuretic action. And they found that the two groups from this sulfonylamide is effective, which inhibit the carbonic anhydrase enzyme. It is simple heterocyclic sulfonylamide and metadisulfamyl benzene derivatives. So first class under this carbonic anhydrase inhibitor is heterocyclic sulfonamides. The first drug under this category is acetazolamide, and the second drug is methazolamide. Acetazolamide, it consists, the IUPAC name is N5-sulfamyl-1,3,4-thiadiazole-2-ylacetamide. So this is the structure of acetazolamide. The acetamido group, this is the acetamido group, NaCOCH3. The remaining part of the structure is bind to this acetamido group from the nitrogen. So here N is written here to this nitrogen. This ring is attached. This ring is called as thiadiazole, and the numbering of this ring is started from sulfur 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this position of sulfur is 1, second nitrogen is 3, third nitrogen is 4. So it is called as 1,3,4 thiadiazole, and it attached to the nitrogen from second position. So here 2, while 2 indicate the attachment of the ring from the second position to the nitrogen. On this ring, the substitution of sulfamyl group at the fifth position. So here 5-sulfamyl-1,3,4-thiadiazole-2-yl, and this total whole group is attached to the nitrogen of acetamide. So this is the IUPAC name. Second drug is methazolamide. The IUPAC name we will see later. Okay. Now the SAR, the other class, we will see in the next part of the lecture or next part of the video. Thank you for listening or your attention.